Key, and welcome to Songs in the Key of Funny.
It's Songs in the Key of Funny, mixing music and comedy. It's like everything you could wish for. It's like an opera singer covered in bees. It's like hearing your favorite song while you eat your favorite cheese. It's funny songs and funny stories. It's Songs in the Key of Funny.
Funny songs and the stories behind them.
Forgot about that part. Hi, everybody.
Hello.
Oh, welcome to Songs in the Key of Funny. I am your host, Kristen Key. Each week, we're going to be talking with a current comedy musician. And each week, I'd like to look back at a classic comedy song and a classic comedy musician to pay homage to those who paved the way for us comedy musicians of today. This week, since the theme of the podcast seems to be children, I chose a song by Tim Wilson called Chuck E. Cheese Hell. And it's a great song. Please download it on iTunes to give him the money, or his family. He passed away. But here's a little snippet of Chuck E. Cheese Hell by the late, great Tim Wilson.
Mama drives Chipper to the Chuck E. Mall, watches him waller in some plastic balls. The band sucks and the pizza's cold, and you eat it with a slobbering four-year-old in Chuck E. Cheese Hell. Chuck E. Cheese Hell!
That's too... You don't have to clap, but you
no,
can.
No.
Anyway, that's our tribute to the late, great Tim Wilson. The song is called Chuck E. Cheese Hell. Please go on iTunes and download that song, and that is our classic comedy song of the week. Classic song of the week. Classic song of the week. All right, so moving on, our guest this week. I'm really excited to have these people. I've seen you once before, but let me give you a really good intro. Okay. I'm about to introduce two saucy moms who blend their ability to harmonize and curse perfectly into a honky-tonk style. They've regularly been seen on the nationally broadcast show Expressing Motherhood. Ladies and gentlemen at home, this is Mommy Tonk.
Thank you, Kristen. Oh, man.
Thank you.
That Chuck E. Cheese song. I mean, my kids request... They want to go to Chuck E. Cheese still. They're 7 and 8. They still want to go to see that mouse. But I had my 13th birthday at a Chuck E. Cheese.
You did.
For real. I wore pink overalls and pink Converse tennis shoes, high tops. And that's when the mouse was still an actual person and not an animatron.
Oh, yeah.
They were both. I worked there for 4 years.
Oh.
And,
wow.
I mean, just fun fact about the balls that he mentioned in the song. They haunted my work experience. They're just covered in urine and feces.
Yeah,
like a crime scene. But people, the way they clean them, they take them in a giant bag, about four giant bags of these balls, and they put them in the back of a pickup truck and run them through a car wash.
No.
Okay.
Don't.
Or at least that's the way they did
at
it at the Chuck E. Cheese on I-40 in Coulter and Amarillo, Texas.
Oh, my God, that is genius. I used to work for Gymboree, and I used to have to clean the mats and the balls and all that. That's so genius. I wish I had known that,
oh,
too.
Oh, man.
Yeah. Chuck, what did you do?
Wash. How did you clean them?
Yeah. There's a lot of Simple Green and a lot of tears.
Each individually? Oh, I know you did it individually.
You know,
you have a cleaning thing.
Yeah, I got a cleaning thing. So I'm like, these are going to be the cleanest balls that Jim Brief has ever seen.
Wow.
So I stalked both of you on Facebook briefly to find out if we were close or not. So Shannon and I, we have 7 mutual friends. So that's not very good. And Stacy, we have 8 mutual friends.
Oh,
thanks
right.
to Tommy Savitt.
Oh, the Tommy Llama.
Yeah, yeah. Hey, Tommy. But it looks like we have a lot in common. We play the guitar, and you're from Louisville.
Yes.
And I've passed out drunk in Louisville.
Oh, me too. Me too.
Lots of times.
Yeah, many times.
So I wanted
recently.
To ask you what's your favorite bar in Louisville first?
Oh, gosh. Okay. Well, I love Headliners because they have great bands come through there. It's a wonderful bar, and it's a great
music.
You don't like music.
No,
I
don't
care. I mean, if I was going to go see music, which I really like to just stay at home, but if I was going to go see music, I would go to Headliners. The Laughing Derby, of course, which is the Comedy Caravan, is a great bar. That's the comedy club, and that's the place
they changed
I
ownership
love.
Again.
That's right.
Now
so now
new name back to
the Comedy Caravan. Right?
I think it's just the Caravan now. But it's like John Mellencamp.
That's right, John Cougar.
No.
There's no cougars. There's a lot of cougars in the Caravan, though.
And we're like, well, we got 2 cougars.
You know what my favorite bar is, though, in Louisville right now? It's called Proof, and it's down at the 21C Hotel, and it's awesome, and it's just like just sexy and hot, and it's downtown in Louisville, and they've done so much remodeling to downtown Louisville that I just love it.
I love the one I asked you what your favorite bar was. You had five.
Oh, yeah. That's there's another one. It's a speakeasy down in Germantown, and it's fairly new from a guy who used to live out in L.A., and he's like, I'm sick of L.A., I'm moving back home to Louisville. He opened a speakeasy.
What do you have to do to get in?
You have to speak easy through the hole, through somebody's hole.
Hey.
Yeah.
Hey, guy. Be cool. Be cool, man. I just want a drink. All right, you're cool.
It's the crazy dive bar around the...
I can't remember the name of that. Oh, my God.
The Highland Tap Room was my favorite. I got 86 from there once for serving myself.
Oh.
That is that... Where'd you pass out drunk? I need to know that.
It would be on Bardstown Road.
Right, that's that. That's the place. Just right on Bardstown Road.
Yeah, I was trying to, they used to put the condo to the caravan like a mile away. And so you could get a ride or you could walk if you were, and I was a bar crawler. And so I would usually just walk across the street to the tap room to have one drink and then get really, really drunk. And then stagger until I would crawl. And then one time I actually just passed out.
Well, that's the place to do it.
Nobody cared.
No.
Nobody called. Like yeah, nobody really, it's not like weird. It's just like, ha ha, look at her. Just another Tuesday.
That street, Bardstown Road, is known for that. I mean, they have something, when you turn 21, if you're in Louisville, you do something called the Bambi Walk. I think that's what it's called. And it's like a bar walk all across Bardstown Road. And many 21-year-olds just end up in the middle of the street, passed out.
Yeah.
So somebody probably thought it was her birthday.
Yeah, probably not 21. She must smoke. You're from Houston.
Yes.
Yeah.
Don't hold it against me.
I'm from Amarillo, so we could not be further apart, but we've seen some shit.
Yeah.
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 So.
Yeah.
What happened?
Why did I leave?
Let's just, yeah, sure. Make up the questions.
Here's the story. You have a childhood?
Yeah. Okay. However far back you want to go. Let's go with your conception. What were your parents on? What happened?
I'm the fifth child.
Okay.
To a blended family.
Okay.
Some addiction and some suicide get together.
Oh, let's skip that part. Okay, let's go to high school.
We go straight to a religious cult, and we spend a lot of time there.
Sorry, I didn't mean to yell.
Witnesses, okay. And so
Church of Christ.
All of that.
Some oil, just hum or no instruments.
Beautiful dysfunction.
Yeah.
Leads to a career in comedy. So it's actually a blessing.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's what. Yeah, yeah, that's what you're.
So I went to UT and then went to New York the day after I graduated.
Okay, and then New York.
Yeah.
Okay. And then both of you are sketch comedy ladies.
I did sketch comedy and improv at Second City and
you
a little bit
Groundlings,
iOS.
Correct?
I did, and I'm far
I Googled
more
the heck out of
you
for like 25 solid minutes.
I did.
That's longer than my husband did.
I've been an improv person.
Okay.
Like, improv is it takes a special ability that I just didn't, it never really clicked for me, but stand-up was always my job.
And you did sketch, right?
I did sketch and improv and a little stand-up.
Okay.
But Second City was, the Second City format is like you improv and then you create a sketch out of that. So it was kind of a blend of it. I loved it.
It's a great program.
I want to get to know you more, but I want to let our viewers and listeners hear your music.
Yeah,
so
let's
what are you playing for us today?
Oh.
Because you get to play a couple at least.
Yay!
How do you want to do this? How do you want to drive this
Well,
train?
You know what? The first song is pretty appropriate to talking about our hometowns. Because we're all from the South here. And this first song was inspired around November 2016.
There was
an election.
It was a primary, like a general election.
A general election that happened. If you can go back to that far. But it was also, we were getting ready to go visit family for Thanksgiving. And it was a heated time of a lot of different opinions. Mm-hmm. You know, we were just a little nervous to travel back home from our hippie, liberal California living.
So we wrote a song for Thanksgiving that now has become sort of a summer song as well, because we're about to go home again for family reunion picnics. And like when I was growing up in the South, my parents had a very strict rule that you never talk politics at the table.
Right.
That was just
it's part of manners. You learn manners in the South. I mean, that's part of your daily routine.
And so my kids are like, "Whoa, Mom, are you really sure you're not gonna be able to make it through a whole meal like without talking about politics in this day and age?" And I'm like, "Sure, I can totally do it." And they're like, "I don't think you can." And I'm like, "Yeah, I can." So then they ask us, "Well, what are you gonna do?" And I said, "Well,
this is what we're gonna do. We're gonna grill those fucking burgers like homeless again." Just right out of the gate.
Oh, that's both of you, too.
Disgusting. Okay, all right. Let's do that again. Right. We're gonna grill those friggin' burgers like we've never grilled before. We're gonna travel to a state where I don't live anymore.
gonna sit down at their table and look them in the eye. I'm gonna keep my friggin' mouth shut while I eat their apple pie. Their apple pie, their apple pie. Don't get more American than good old apple pie. And diversity. I'm gonna look around my childhood home and wonder how we all got here. I'm gonna see that family Bible underneath that big old D. I'm gonna look that dead deer in the eye and ask if he can see. This blessed cornucopia of our hypocrisy. Hypocrisy, hypocrisy. Don't get more American than good old hypocrisy. And apple pie. I want to thank my mom and daddy for raising me upright. I'm going to thank the sweet Lord above for showing me the light. But I'm not sure they're praying to the same guy at night. Because my version of him is brown and theirs is lily white. He's lily white. And fly my ass back home, where all my friends are lesbians and I never feel alone. My neighbor is a Muslim and my best friend is a Jew. And I love every damn one of them cause Jesus told me to. He told me to. He told me to. Looks like I was listening. Well, I thought they were too. Oh, apple pie. Oh, apple pie. Don't get more American than good old apple pie.
God bless some Americans.
Might actually be one thing that is more American than apple pie, and it's something that like can unify moms, especially like when you become a new mom. There's this one place you find yourself all the time.
Yeah,
it happens to be our favorite place, and it happens to be the unifier in America.
Yeah, it's the great. I don't know a single person that doesn't like it.
No, and it's this place.
Gotta go to Target, 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 Target, here we come. Gotta get some soap, gotta get a lamp, gotta get a brush and toothpaste too. Gotta get a mug, gotta get a frame, gotta get a whoa.
Girl, do you see that shirt over there?
Girl, you love shirts.
Put it in the cart! Gotta go to Target, 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 Target, here we come. Gotta get Clorox, gotta get wipes, gotta get a towel and a washcloth too. Gotta get Band-Aids, gotta get a rug, gotta get a whoa.
Did you know they sell wine at Target?
When did they start selling wine at Target?
We love wine. Put it in the cart. Gotta go to Target, 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 Target, here we come. Gotta get headphones, gotta get a CD, gotta get a movie and a flat screen too. Gotta get popcorn, gotta get chips, gotta get a whoa.
What is it?
Do you see that red ceramic squirrel over there?
Girl, you love
you know, that whole family of squirrels is coming home with me because I have a serious squirrel problem.
You did put them all in the car. There's no food. Don't pay any squirrels.
I feel like I'm losing control. We gotta get out of here.
Girl, we have not hit the end of the aisle.
Right. That's all. Clearance.
Get another cart. A blue unicorn, a yellow cuckoo clock, a whimsical mat, and some mismatched socks. Red flannel sheets and a papasan chair.
I'm gonna go.
All right. Let's check out.
Okay.
Scan, beep, scan, beep, scan, beep, scan, beep, scan, beep, scan, beep.
I'm sorry, what'd you say?
$642.38.
Well, how'd that happen?
My husband is gonna kill me.
Oh, well.
Put it in the cart. Put it in the cart. Put it in the cart, put it in the cart. We'll sneak it in the house, we'll hide it in the closet.
Ah, dang it.
Wait, what is it?
I totally forgot toilet paper.
Oh, man, that is the whole reason that we came.
Well, you know what that means.
I do, girl. Gotta go to Target, 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 gotta go to Target. Target.
City. That's what
we say with
blank, blank, blank,
yeah.
blank, blank.
Yeah.
Blank.
And then I sang, I wrote a love song for my husband that basically, he works too much. He's an ad man, so he's always gone. And so I wrote, really, it's actually kind of a sweet song, but in it I say that if he doesn't come home, that I'm going to start stripping our whole day. And so that was awesome.
I would listen to that. Yeah.
So that's the beginning. And then we started writing together.
Yeah, I'm going to start blanking the pool blank.
Blankety blank. Once we realized, we started touring around doing these songs for Expressing Motherhood. And then one time in Chicago, we were like, why don't we sing on each other's?
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, we knew we could harmonize. We knew that we used to both sing in church
choirs.
That's
what I was going to ask next, because my brother runs a karaoke bar in Texas. And when I go back to visit him, we always sing and we harmonize together because we grew up singing together.
Right.
And he always says, oh, I'm so glad you're here. There's not a lot of people that can harmonize with me. You know, I say, I have that complaint when I travel around. You know, there's just no one to harmonize with.
Yeah.
I grew up in church, and I don't want to have to go to church
to
have some good
just
singing.
Just to harmonize.
You know, I just want to harmonize. It doesn't mean I want to, and I still love to play and sing gospel songs.
Of yes, of course. That's the root of it all.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
And you can find someone who can harmonize with you. That's just, it's just something you can't be bought. You can't go to the mall and pick up a harmony partner.
No.
You know what I mean?
No.
Well, you did. You did kind of.
Well,
it was a street corner.
It was a Target, but whatever. I heard it was either Donnie or Marie. I get them confused. They're the same team. But they said once that siblings harmonize the best, or family members harmonize the best, because you have, like, I think that was just their way of saying, listen to us, we're the odds ones.
Yeah.
No one harmonizes.
Yeah.
But you
and your brother?
I mean,
I want to know what the karaoke jam is. Where is that?
All right, so
plug
for my brother. He runs a karaoke night at Pizza Hut on, I think it's Tuesdays and Friday. He's
the best
man if I get it wrong.
I
know. So if you're in Amarillo, and it's family friendly, so bring your kids, and I hope they like cigarette smoke.
Oh, God.
Because it's a
That sounds awesome.
I
love Pizza Hut.
So what's your karaoke jam? What do you say?
Okay, I usually start with Total Eclipse of the Heart. Because it's fun. And then Brand New Key by Melanie.
Okay.
Okay, you go. What
are
you?
I'm Janis Joplin, of course.
Bobby
McGee. And
that's
Patsy Cline.
Which one?
Crazy. I can bring the house down.
Crazy. I bet you could.
I basically break out in hives when someone asks me to do karaoke.
She doesn't like it.
I love to go.
I want to throw this at you.
I know. It's terrible. It's terrible. It's like
letters. Letters and
letters
songs in the key of funny. Just to berate her. Frustrating.
I don't know why. Like, I don't know. I love to go, and I will sing, and if I sing, it's going to be like musical theater.
But you play and you sing.
I know. Isn't that bizarre?
In your own band.
I feel like my goal for that, I'm about to turn 45, and I think my goal.
It's LA. You're 27.
I literally am about to turn 27, and my goal for my 27th year is I'm going to sing four karaoke nights. Four karaoke nights and sing.
I would
like to drive. I'll be your designated driver.
Okay,
dude,
thank you.
This is happening.
Because I do need to
I'm serious.
I literally break out in hives just thinking about
it. I'm going to watch even more than the singing. And I went to school to be a paramedic.
Oh, perfect. I'm saying
you're
a
sober
driver.
I never graduated.
Oh, shit. You should totally let me die.
Some cream.
Oh, my God. I'm going
to
die.
Oh, what could possibly happen in
Tokyo?
Somebody's a doctor. So if you were, like, close your eyes and pretend like you're. You don't have to for real, but for play, what songs would you sing?
It takes two to make a thing go right from Rob Bates. That's what I would say.
You need to make this happen. Like,
after we finish,
no,
we're
we
going just straight there now.
Screw the show. Let's just get up and go. Episode 2 is canceled.
Songs
we'll be in here at karaoke. Yeah.
In the karaoke.
That's a good show, too. Songs in the Key of Karaoke.
Yeah.
Copyrighted just right now by me. Can you just say copywritten and it's copywritten?
Yeah, it's
done. Copywritten.
Do you have to go like this, though?
Copywritten.
Circle
C.
You put a C in your middle.
I need to take my finger. I don't know how to copyright things.
It's tricky.
So it takes two to make the go right.
That would be my karaoke song.
Okay.
And maybe like.
You have to put in three slips.
The girl from the Grease song, I'd have to get a guy, or you could do it with me.
Oh.
Summer 11. Yeah, Summer 11.
Yeah, I ran a karaoke bar for 2 years.
How do
you think my brother got the job?
I mean, is it interesting that both of you and your brother went in a music kind of direction?
Yeah, from Church of Christ, which has no instruments in the music. And
that's why we sang, and I think it was to rebel, I think that's why he started playing the guitar. And then because we've always been super competitive, I wanted to learn the guitar too, but he would only teach me a little bit here and there.
Of course, yeah.
And then I practiced, and I learned the banjo.
You're so
stuff
on the
so
target
much.
Song.
Well, actually, I don't.
I was the weakest band member on that song. I think we all know it.
There's we're working on this song about that. We're working on a new song that has a little bit more of a country flair. That if we have time at the end, we'd love to like play the first few chords.
I don't know what time we started? I bet we have time.
And you,
it's our show.
Yeah,
we
can.
We want.
You should come in. You should play on
okay.
that. Okay. And I'll and we'll do. We'll talk.
Yeah, let's
we'll
do
talk
a
for a second.
So
yeah.
that those at home that are watching can play their banjos.
Right.
Too.
Exactly.
Because yeah.
right.
so, I'm sure I wasn't the only one at home going, wait, what?
What is that?
Yeah, weren't we embarrassed?
It's okay, our band, we normally play with our band, which is the Assless Chaps.
I saw that
and,
on a video. Where did you find these people? They're incredible.
They are incredible. I used to work at the Geffen Playhouse over by UCLA, and I worked there for like 14 years. And there's a guy there, his name is Mark Sanfilippo, and he's worked there for about 14 years too, and we've been friends forever. And he's a drummer in town, and he literally is like the best jazz drummer in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
We love him, Mark Sanfilippo. And so one day Stacey and I were playing, and we've been playing for a while, and we're like, you know what, wouldn't it be fun to have a band back us up, like legit musicians, because I can barely play the guitar, as you can see. And we were like, yeah, let's do it. I was like, you know what, I'm going to talk to Mark, because Mark knows all the band people in town. So I walked over to Mark's desk, and I was like, hey, you've seen Stacey and I do our act, would you be interested in playing on it, and maybe helping us find like a fiddle player? What do you think might work? He's like, you need an upright fiddle and me. And I was like, let's do it. Mm-hmm. So he pulled it together. He called out on a fiddle player that he knew that used to play with like Dust Bowl Revival, mm-hmm. and this upright bass guy that plays with them all the time. And
their names are Corey Simeone and Gabe Davis.
And
I
Gabe Davis.
Nice
oh, yeah, Gabe Davis is the most amazing upright player, and
yeah.
Corey Simeone is a fiddle player none you've
yeah.
ever seen.
He's a showstopper, that one. We're
he
like,
is.
Hey, we're working up here. They're like, we want to know the fiddle player. We're like, oh, let's
just take the center stage. And they're just a really great trio. They actually have their own band now called Ike's Creek. And
I think Assless Chaps.
But
yeah.
I know, we're like, why didn't you name yourself the Assless Chaps? It's the greatest name.
It is.
So they play with us, and they're, Mark plays with a lot of comedy bands in town. He plays the Rudy Cassoni show when
Tom
that happens.
Kenny.
Tom Kenny. He plays with a lot of people,
yeah.
and so he knows timing. And it's important, as you know. Like
yeah.
you're telling jokes, and you're writing songs, and you want to stop in the middle of the song, and something happens, or you mess up like I do every single time I play a song. He can do that, and he's fun, and he'll do some riffs on his drum kit. So that's how we found them, and we play with them a lot. We usually tour the South with them. We've done this for 3 summers. And sometimes we go up just ourselves, too, so we don't always play with them. But it's such a fun, rich show when there's the 5 of us on stage.
I love it because it takes, like, you, I love your music, and I love how irreverent you make parenting,
mm-hmm.
you know? But when you put fantastic musicians behind you, it becomes an experience.
Aw, thank
you.
You.
I mean, and as a duo, it works. But as a band, it just, I think it adds several more layers. Really fun to watch though, because I did start you online.
Oh.
I have a question about
your
writing process.
Okay.
So how do you guys write a song?
Most are born out of frustration.
Okay.
So, you know, if one of us is having a bad day or there's an issue that's troubling us, we have to get through the angry stage and then we go, okay, let's make it funny.
I feel like a lot of times we come with that idea and we sit down and we just kind of start. Stacey plays the piano too, so we either do it at the piano or we do it at the guitar.
I have a piano right there. It's
play it.
It does not keep tune. It'll
That's
be all right.
It's perfect.
Yeah.
I don't keep tune either. You heard that, right?
I can't play in your key, so this is
we're perfect. This is the greatest trio
yeah.
ever.
We'll be the crotchless panties,
which I'm wearing right now. So sorry. Those of you, oh, it's a podcast.
Off
you
the couch.
Dressed up today. You don't really know where anything. All right.
We just Lysoled that couch
oh.
from the last crotchless panties.
Oh. That's our next band.
So yeah, sometimes we just riff and then, you know.
Hey, do you go tune first or lyrics first?
We've done both. Like Stacey will sometimes come to me with like the lyrics that she's written and it's amazing, like this poetry
yeah.
on paper. Oh. And then we'll pick up the guitar and I'll be like, all right, I know 3 chords. What arrangement can we do? And then we'll just kind of start like, I don't know, we'll just start. This is I want to hear your process because sometimes I'm like, is this right? But it doesn't matter if it's right. It
yeah.
works for us.
Yeah.
We're just like,
it's your song.
I don't know.
Yeah.
It's just a melody, and then we'll just start.
Most of them are pretty simple, so yeah.
I mean, literally, we'll do that for an hour or two, and we'll play around with it, and then we'll spend a couple days editing it, fine-tuning it, chopping lyrics, chopping chords.
Do you find it gets wordy? Do you ever write them too wordy and then have to cut back?
Yes.
Because that's my mind start out with sentences that need to be
yeah,
5 words instead
yeah.
of 10. Because
yeah.
I think I can squeeze all those words.
Oh, like putting a show together, or what?
Like writing a song.
Yeah, absolutely.
We
have very similar sensibilities as to what
and
works.
Humor looks like,
because
too.
Generally the criteria is, did it make us laugh so hard that we almost fell off the couch?
Yeah.
And they're like, well, okay, there's
okay, that goes,
that's
definitely
it.
Right.
And
down.
It's funny sometimes. You know, we've been working together for so many years. We will, like the apple pie song that we did. I got to her
song.
House because we were so upset at that time because the election didn't turn out in our favor and. I got to her house and I'm like, gotta do something, we gotta say something. We gotta, you know, and a lot of people say, don't go political. People don't go to Mommy Tom for politics. And I'm like, well, the song's not really political, but it does have a, you know, philosophy behind it.
Right.
And I got to her house and she says, I've got the first line. And she said, we're gonna, you know, at the time it was, we're gonna
cook that
friggin' turkey like we've never cooked before. And I was like, done. And we just ran to the table and we just wrote it right there and then shot it because I had to get all the way back across town. Wrote it, shot
a
video.
Well, that's an important part of our process. It's always highly, there's
we have this much time.
We have this much time because one of us has to go pick up a child.
I read a book, The Beatles by Bob Spitz, and it was about Lennon and McCartney and how they wrote their songs.
Mm.
They would put a time limit on them, and they wouldn't give it longer than 3 hours.
Well,
that's
maybe
smart.
That's helpful to us.
It is helpful.
I
thought about
it. I read that, I was like, I mean, I'll get caught in a song for days and just be like, I just can't, I'm stuck on it. If I would just go,
yeah,
screw it.
Yeah.
Because when are you ever finished? Like, when are you ever done with it? Like, we're
yeah.
still, like, even just
yeah.
playing now, I'm like, oh, that could probably be a
yeah.
little different or better.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
I gotta be done with it.
But
time.
I have,
a new song.
Yeah,
you
gotta go on.
Yeah. Someone gave us advice, advice years ago, and she said, if you're ever 60% sure of something, you've made your decision. And so I kind
60%
of.
60% sure I'm not pregnant.
I'm 60% sure.
So I just kind of,
I'm pretty good at, maybe sometimes a little.
It's not the last decision we'll ever make. That's
yeah, exactly.
Like, let's just write the song. It's not the last song.
That.
Well,
I could die. I could fall off the stage.
They're gonna cut that burger. Plane engine just fell on you. That's what that was.
yeah, but the writing process is super fun. And the other thing that's really enjoyable is when we have shows that are out of town, we can both get away from our families in a space where we don't get distracted by laundry and school pickups and this, that, and the other. And so if we're ever in a hotel room and there happens to be Tito's vodka there, we can find
it's
inspiration.
The best
it is the
buy
best.
Buy Tito's vodka. Go
it
to the store
Tito's.
Right now and
Tito's.
Buy Tito's vodka. Yeah.
It's our plug.
It is. It's from Texas.
But
it is the best vodka. It was my drink.
It literally is the
very
best.
It
yeah.
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 It's
wonderful.
Very smooth. Tito's
it's made
vodka.
From
letters.
At
Songs in the Key of Chris. Oh, sorry. Songs in the Key of Funny.
So yeah, the writing process is fun, and putting a show together is fun because we do a 90-minute show with the band, and we introduce different characters in the show where
I saw
play,
you bearded.
Yeah, the men.
Yeah.
Well,
you
we have these guys that follows around. You should have them on your show, actually. They call themselves Daddy Tonk.
Okay.
For whatever reason. And they follow us around. Sometimes they help us load up the truck at night. But they have their own set of songs
yeah.
that they're the most sexist comedians you've ever
yeah,
met in your life.
They're awful. We hate
they're
them.
Terrible.
They
have
leave us alone.
They literally have a song called Women Ain't Funny.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Jerks.
Yeah. I mean,
yeah.
Even stuff like that comes from some form.
It's true. It's true.
So when you, okay, since you have these home lives where you have children and husbands and
yeah.
I'm sure you have to do the whole routine.
The
I mean,
routine.
Now they're getting a little older, but still, they don't, really,
gets,
they don't want to take care of themselves.
But it gets
I'm
more
childless,
complicated.
Sure.
You know, like, I was thinking, oh, well, when they're older, it's different work, but it's still a lot. You have a lot of things to
do. A lot of emotional
cover.
Stuff that you have to take care
oh,
of with them,
yeah.
right? Don't they have little feelings?
They have
little
feelings.
I'm against
that.
Yeah.
They do have little
I don't
feelings.
Like my own feelings.
No.
I know.
It's hard.
So when you go on the road, though, is it just like, do you just like clock out and just be like, wow?
Well, it's
the
funny.
First time we did.
The we have those experiences.
21
where
years
we're
in
like,
Vegas.
All right.
I've got a yard and daiquiri.
Please. I have a husband who travels constantly. So when I'm gone and
he's
gone, yeah,
And so he can kind of hold down the fort, and he's great at that. When I come home, then no dishes been done, no laundry's been done, because that's not what men do.
They are alive.
They don't care. Everyone's alive. Everyone's had fun, and I just do the dishes. You know,
kids all have hangovers. Who cares?
They're fine though.
Everyone died from a hangover.
Yeah, it's all good.
13.
Yeah. But when we do, it is nice to have a little bit of a break because when you're not at home, when you're at home writing, we either go to her house or my house. When we're at my house, sometimes like. I see the dishes in my dishes while I'm in the middle of a song. I'm like, I should really wash those dishes. Oh, no, wait, what's the record are we on?
Yeah. But we should write a song about me doing the dishes right now.
Yeah, but then sometimes we do, so it does help us. Mm-hmm. Then when we're at a hotel, I feel like we can really focus in and take those 3 solid hours and write and not be distracted by anything but the bar bottle of Tito's.
Hey.
Tito's vodka.
Made in Austin, Texas. What's your guilty pleasures? What are you, is it you got any TV shows that you... guiltily watch. I feel like there's one. Come, Stacy.
Stacy just did a tilt swing around on the
chair.
What
is it?
I was just fixing it.
By the way, I mean, future shows. How is this feeling? You comfortable?
You know, I mean, it feels like if someone were. I feel like maybe I should lay down on it, and then it would like, it could like.
Oh, this got way better.
A little bit.
You just feng shuied the hell out of the set.
It's a really comfy couch. It feels like it's been lived in a little bit.
I think it has.
I mean, I do want to close it up on myself.
You can just taco on the couch.
Guilty pleasure. That was the
question.
Speaking
of tacoing the couch.
I love... sorry.
We're wearing cocktail pants. Sorry. Please don't
taco
on the couch.
Taco the couch.
Oh,
excuse me. Okay.
No, I love live music. I love... I love sleep.
Under some layers.
I love nature documentaries.
Nate, now we're getting better.
I love
nature
wine. I mean, really, my perfect evening is a nature documentary with a bottle of wine, and I'm
sleep.
Like the happy and
yeah.
sleep, because nothing
so
lulls me
you
to
like
sleep.
Earth, yeah.
I do. Nothing lulls me to
yeah.
sleep more than a British man whispering to me about the mating habits of animals in their natural habitat.
Oh, that bird. That's how that
it's
bird
just,
attracts its
mate. Just
what
I'm
just gonna pass out.
Yeah.
Keep
I'm like, I swear to God, if there's a British man talking on television, I'm like, it's like propofol to me.
This is fun.
Yeah.
But I'm not as exciting as she is. She has a lot
excited.
More.
I don't, what do you mean?
Well, now I gotta know.
We're definitely the odd couple.
I mean, seriously, I mean,
she's
watching
nature programs,
you
just male porn.
Just porn.
But you gay male porn. That's
I
all.
Literally was thinking how boring my guilty pleasure is because it's listening to self-help books on
she
audio.
She does like that. She
literally,
does.
That
these
is my guilty
pleasure. These are the women,
porn.
I mean, if I want, call down the mommy talk poll for a minute and watch some of their YouTube videos and the things that they say on stage, and then now that I'm like trying to uncover their dirty little secrets, they're like self-help books.
I was so worried.
Oh my
god.
Oh my god.
But you know,
I mean, my guilty pleasure. I mean, I don't know how. I live in California. I have a prescription for marijuana.
What?
That could be a guilty pleasure, I guess.
What?
A little bit.
I mean, if
you know, I had a reason for it.
If my mom
point.
Saying it, yes, that would be.
You know, maybe that's my guilty pleasure that I partake in sometimes, and when we're on the road, maybe more, because I can just sit outside of our hotel room and be like, okay, this is cool.
I crochet.
Yes, I love it.
I crochet, and I watch Buffy the Vampire Slayer when I really need to unwind. So I understand.
See,
get it?
Sometimes you just gotta be real, like...
So we're just old. We're getting old.
We're old.
Okay. Well, so here, how about this? When you were younger, do you have any, like when I was a kid, I had a poster of Patrick Swayze on my door.
Oh, yes.
Yeah,
oh.
And I listened to the Dirty Dancing soundtrack every single day. And when I used to get drunk, I would always bring that up to my wife every single time.
Oh, yeah.
Did you know that I used to have a poster of Patrick Swayze? Yeah, shut up. Like, we need to watch Dirty Dancing right now. What's your musical, like, dirty little secret? Do you have a band that you obsessed over? Was there someone that you... an album that you played till it was raw?
I have several.
Okay.
Chicago 17. Rod Stewart, literally Rod Stewart, pulled me on stage. I was so obsessed with
him.
I came from the back of a stadium in Louisville, Kentucky.
Is he worse looking in person?
He's so hot.
Oh!
He's
okay.
So hot.
I've already done this a couple times.
He's so hot.
No!
He pulled me. Yes, he is. And
okay,
he was
like. Agree to disagree. Letters. At songsofthekeyoffunny.com. Always directed at Chan.
20 years ago, like he was even hotter. And he, or 20, more than 20 years ago. So I was obsessed with
that. Maybe that was the spell he cast.
That was the
thing. He sang to you.
But Weird Al Yankovic was literally one of my favorite. And he also sang to me, came out from the stage in Louisville, smart
you. No offense with you. Like, what you? What's
I don't know.
What's special about you?
I draw people to me.
That's
with my, I'm listening to self-help. I'm cross-stitching, and they're like, what are you doing? And Julie Brown. I love Julie Brown. Love and Grateful Dead. I have so many music people that I love that have nothing to do with each other. Beastie Boys, Grateful Dead, Julie Brown, because I'm blonde.
Yeah.
I should have stuck to my note cards. That was my first question, was your influences in music, comedy, and otherwise. And I forgot
well, I can answer that.
Now we're coming.
I mean, there's
anyway.
A lot of musical influences, comedy-wise.
Well, I'll answer both questions.
Yeah.
So, I am the most boring human being.
Obviously.
The album that I wore out, my 33 vinyl, was the soundtrack to Out in Africa.
Oh, my God.
It fits in with your guilty pleasure.
And
yeah.
I ended up marrying a guy who was born in Africa.
Does he have a soothing South African voice?
No, he's British, and he doesn't even
Does
have that.
Does he lull you to sleep every time you're in his mouth?
He doesn't have his accent, but if he did, I would probably sleep with
him. What, did he get rid of his accent?
Well, he moved to Texas. If you're a little British kid in Texas, in
you just drop your accent?
You drop it real quick,
or
they drop it for you. Yeah, exactly. Okay, so that was the album that I wore out, and I know it sounds silly, but I just really like soothing,
you
beautiful
rebel. You two
music.
Rebels.
But I'll tell you what else I did, though, because I grew up in a very, restrictive...
Oh,
kind of
a show?
Friends are friends forever, if the Lord's the Lord of them. And a friend will not say never, cause the friendship will not end. Though it's hard to let you go, in the Father's hands we know that a lifetime's not too long to live as friends.
Guys, did we just
totally, we totally went back to our roots there.
Michael
awesome.
W. Smith, people.
Oh my.
Didn't he do it with Amy Grant? That was just what we just did.
We just testified. This is.
I sang that a lot as a teenager.
Oh. Wow.
We all did. But okay, so the other thing is, when I grew up in a very restrictive religious situation, I would bring home cassette tapes and play them for my brother, my older brother, who was into heavy rock. And I was like, that's the devil's music, and you're obviously going to hell, so you need to listen to this tape, and it will save your soul. And he'd look at me like, oh my God, now I'm in a rock band. So I'm like, oh, okay, maybe it's not good. But
it didn't save him soul.
My musical influence across the board, the person who, just changed my whole perspective on everything is Tim Minchin, who is an Australian piano player.
Of course.
He's genius, and he also is a Broadway composer, so he doesn't only do musical comedy. He wrote the score
so
for Matilda,
okay.
And right. Also Groundhog Day, which just started, which just opened on Broadway. But if you've never heard of Tim Minchin, I highly recommend it. It
Tim Minchin, letters at
Sounds
the Key of Funny.
He's the greatest.
He's great.
Tell Stacy
mm-hmm.
to wake up.
Yeah.
Woke.
Right. I guess that's those weren't really the dirty little secrets I was looking for. We learned a lot about you.
Well, when you're married, you don't
say
your dirty secrets on the podcast.
I guess
I'm
that's
joking.
True.
I'm kidding. I have no guilt. I'm really boring. I'm so boring. The first time we traveled together was in Chicago, and we got a hotel room together, and we're like away from our kids. I'm away from my kids for one of the first times ever. We check into the room, and I'm like, jammies, and I put on PBS, and she's like, are you nuts? Like, we're going out. I'm like, no, I really just want to do this.
Under no, like, for me. It's my
oh
fantasy.
My God, I am literally going to
eat Cheetos in someone else's bed.
Boring.
That would be.
Literally. I'm so boring.
So what comedy songs? What comedy songs inspired you? Like, classic comedy songs?
Well, literally, I mean, come on.
Weird
Al.
Just
I mean, that was one of the first. Like, Eat It. Weird Al was in the beginning of Julie Brown, because I'm a blonde, and that Homecoming Queen album.
I'm going to get her on the show. Look out, Julie
Are you
Brown.
Serious?
Yeah,
I mean,
if you do,
can I come
see
out?
We share an agent, and I've asked my agent, and so we're just putting it out there.
She did the show.
I'm coming for you, Julie Brown.
Julie, you're my hero, like, for real. Like, listening to that cassette, because I'm a blonde, hi. I literally, it made me... I don't know what I'm trying to say. I just loved her. I fell in love with it, and it started me wanting to do that.
But
when I got to Second City, that's what it did. I was like, I'm going to write songs on Julie Brown.
I was
going to
take
my monologues and turn them into comedy songs. Because that's what Julie Brown did, and that's sort of what Weird Al Yankovic does. And I love
Tenacious D would be the thing that, for me, I was like, oh, well, they're doing it. Exactly. You're right. You know what I mean? And I was on the front row of many a show back in the 90s before they got, at the smaller venues. And they just, I was like, what is this whole thing? I love it so much. And it's okay. But so Tenacious D, yeah, for sure.
Oh, yeah.
Love them.
That's a tight duo right there.
Yeah. They are. And kids, to, like, we just met these young, these, I guess they're like 19-year-olds. We just did a show, and they were in another show at the same theater. And they really liked us, and it was so nice. They're like 19-year-old boys. We're like, oh, my gosh, thank you. That's so great. Like, we love Tenacious D, and you're kind of like Tenacious D for moms.
Like, yeah,
we were like that. It was like the best praise ever. And also to realize that 19-year-olds still like Tenacious D. I mean, these guys,
yeah.
they're classic.
I found
they're
their CD the other day in my garage, and I was like, I'm going to pop it in. It holds up. It holds
classic.
Up.
They're great.
Yeah,
I'm just
like,
oh,
they're
right.
Yeah.
That'd be a good thing. You should get them on the show.
Work on that. Coming for you, Tenacious
Come on,
D.
Come
Jack. Yeah. Yeah, you never know who will agree to do weird things. You got a third song in that?
Okay, now listen. I want you to get your banjo players with us.
All right, banjo
We're
players, pay attention.
We
She's telling us how.
We don't really know. This is a new song, but I have the capo. If anyone's playing the guitar, I have the capo on the first fret. So for you, Kristen, that first chord is F for you without a capo. And D, I guess. Wait, what's that? Or is that A sharp? So this is the one.
What's the F?
This. And then I go to a, that's a B. So that's it. So it's like, dun, dun. Those are the whole chords. You know what, let's take the capo off. Will it be easier?
Sure.
Take the capo off. So this is finger E.
Actually, quite the opposite. I feel like there's more, you're elevated if you're a musical comedian.
Yeah.
find there's a stigma with being a mom comic. And that is something we battle. Because we're like, oh, we're not a mommy act. We talk about parenting and relationships and motherhood, but like people who are 19-year-old kids.
Right.
So like, we're not just pandering to the mom crowd. I hope that we can span different.
Well, I think absolutely it's because you have good jokes, great timing. And if you have good jokes with great timing, you can, and you reach a lot of subjects. You also happen to talk about what your lives are
right
now.
Sure.
That you happen to be moms that like Tito's vodka.
Right, exactly.
Well,
you know?
Yes.
Our best audience, though, is this really awesome audience in Harlingen, Texas, which is on the border of Mexico, and it was filled with mostly men. Cowboys.
Building a wall.
Yeah, where it was before, it's before the, it's pre-wall, pre-wall letters. At
I'm just going to say.
In case this airs in like a year or so.
Yeah.
Right.
This was before
this
the wall.
PW.
The houses in Harlingen, Texas have never been dirtier since the election. A lot of people lost their help.
Oh.
I don't know why she even did it.
I don't know.
So weird.
It's a mystery.
It's the
weirdest thing.
Just those cowboys loved us.
Yeah, they did.
They did. Like that was fun for us because we do get that label, like mom comics. I mean, it's in our title, you know, we're mommy tonk, of course.
Yeah.
But.
Well, you know what? I have a lot of mom friends that, as just as mothers, don't want to be. They don't want to feel like a mom all the time,
right?
You know, it's like, I don't want to, I don't know, it's like when I tell my mom I'll pick out something for me to wear, like, you look cute, this is like, I don't look like a mom. She's like, there's nothing wrong with looking like a mom. I'm like, I didn't mean it like that.
Yeah.
Just like, so I get it. There's
it's
a
thing.
Stigma with being
it's like,
a mom.
I'm not going to shop at Chico's. I won't.
All of my favorite jeans are from Chico's, and my mother gave them to me.
I was
going to
say, there's ladies in this room, it's like, I love Chico's.
I do too.
And
what's
I
wrong
know.
With Chico's? They
but
fit my
me,
pants.
That is the thing that is like,
I'm too
the
tall.
Thing that, you know, I'm like, I associate Chico's with, well, you know, my mom takes me there, she's like, he looks so cute.
That never goes away. When you're a mom, you still have a mom that still treats you like, you know, you would look cute in this. You know, if you would just fix your
just,
hair different,
just
you'd be prettier.
Yeah.
That hurts.
Just try, honey.
I've never seen my mom's nails. I've never seen her nails without polish on or her toenails. Never.
Oh, mine right now, I could climb trees with them.
I know.
And
oh my God.
Blue, but only on the tips.
That's fancy.
Well, I think we hit the old. We're good.
Yeah.
Plug what you're working on because you guys are so fantastic. I'm so happy that you're on the show.
Well, we love. Directing people to our online presence, which is Facebook and then Instagram and YouTube.
And what is your handle on Twitter?
At Mommy Tonk.
At Mommy Tonk. And it's www.mommytonk.com.
Mm-hmm.
Their website is fantastic. I went. They have lots of YouTube videos, so visit that. Let's try to get more mutual friends.
Yes.
Yeah,
we need to work on
each other.
7-8.
And we're looking at some dates in Santa Barbara and possibly Mill Valley at the Throckmorton Theater for the fall, but we don't have any details on that just yet. But
people go
we
to
have a little
keep a
abreast
of your
keep abreast
of your Tonkin
of, all
of our Tonkin
and our presence.
Well, like we want to do, you know, we want to do a big live stage show with kind of like
with
other musical
audience. Our dream, this is our dream show. You ready
for
this?
No, I'm
with us. Dream show. Here you go. Dream show. Let's manifest. Ace Hotel Theater, the Ace Hotel.
I don't even know what that is.
Well, it's awesome. It's the greatest venue in downtown. By the Ace Hotel, there's a theater in there.
Okay.
Lots of quirky acts. Okay, this is our dream bill, right?
Okay.
Kristen Key.
Oh, I know her.
The show.
I can get her on.
The show.
I know them.
Mommy Tonk. The Lampshades.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Will there be assless chaps?
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
yeah.
Can we all play together?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
I think, that
I
would like
really
to
fun.
Manifest this because I've seen a lot, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I've seen a lot.
Yeah.
Or even at Flappers.
I think we need to do
I think
it
we
at
could
Flappers.
Do a couple shows at Flappers.
I think we need to do some Flappers.
By the way, any letters, please send the letters at songsinthekeyoffunny.com. Thank you for listening. Watch new episodes on our YouTube channel. That's Songs in the Key of Funny. It'll be on iTunes every Monday. And thank you, Flappers, for letting us on.
Thanks for having us, Kristen. It's Flappers.